Oh. Oh, we getting fancy now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What's going on now?
Little bit.
Got the gunshots.
A little bit of Kanye,
Con Man.
You know what I'm saying? Okay.
It's a celebration for my boy, you're not the sunken place.
All right. So what's been going on since last time we had this conversation?
So first off, the last 20 minutes of the last show was not me. That was my cousin BJ. Secondly,
what happened in the last 20 minutes?
It was a lot of, you know, arguing and disagreeing and, you know, some childish behavior on my cousin part. You know what I'm saying? I could feel myself talking slower as the show went on. I went from happy jovial to talking. I don't think that I should be doing this right now. So
that's the bullshit you was drinking. Yeah.
Unbeknownst to my brother, Aaron, I've been trying out a new liquor every time we do a show, just to see, you know, to add to the ambiance of, you know, and the last liquor, it was not a good idea. I don't think I'm gonna do that one again.
So now I guess this pod is sponsored by Rams Point Peanut Butter Whiskey.
Yes, peanut butter whiskey.
I ain't drinking this shit. I'm drinking Martell Blue Swift.
Yeah, unless it's when you wanna have your doo-doo smell twice as bad as it normally does, you drink peanut butter whiskey, like I'm doing right now.
Yeah, it sound harsh, bro.
It has a caramel taste to it. You know, caramel. But we had the Grammys. We had I have some really deep rooted feelings about the Grammys, and you said you didn't really watch it, but Meg Thee Stallion won 2 Grammys.
What she won Grammys for?
I think Song of the Year, and she had a collabo with Beyonce won something, and she performed.
So who was up for Song of the Year?
Let me see. I'll tell you who it was. It was some people that we don't know, don't care about, hard to listen to. And let me see.
After you do this, I feel like you're finna give me reasons why Meg Thee Stallion shouldn't have won Song of the Year.
No. I'm not finna go there.
What she won Song of the Year for? What song was it, though?
I'm sorry. Her won Song of the Year.
Oh.
Her.
Sounds like she deserved that.
Yeah.
I like her.
Yeah. But
what Meg win?
Meg won, let's see.
Did she perform WAP? Wet Ass Pussy?
They did perform WAP.
Her and Cardi. I saw you had a little comment on the face of the book.
You know, so, okay, let's go deep in this. Okay. I'm going to ask you a question. When has a man ever made a song about his peen that was a Grammy nominated song? Exactly.
Never. I was gonna. Did Throw Baby win any?
Throw Baby didn't get nominated. Okay.
What was the other one that put it in your mind? Did he win anything when that shit dropped? He didn't get nominated.
Right. When can a man it's just like, and I'm saying this because, why has 6ix9ine won any Grammys?
I don't listen to 6ix9ine. I don't know.
Because if Megan won a Grammy, then 6ix9ine definitely deserves a Grammy.
Why?
Because love him or hate him, he is doing everything that every one of the Grammy nominated artists have done, whether it be changing the culture of music, whether it be having fanfare, whether it be record sales, he qualifies. I'm gonna put some on you like this. Without 6ix9ine, there is no Griselda Records.
What?
Yeah. Without 6ix9ine,
there's no.
Because before 6ix9ine, what was hip hop doing in New York?
I mean,
what was the trend of the music?
I don't know. Tell me what you thought about it. Because this is the thing. I only listen to 6ix9ine I heard like maybe one or two songs because he was on a Breakfast Club and I was trying to figure out why he was getting so much pub. Mm-hmm. Nothing about 6ix9ine ever made me want to listen to a song.
6ix9ine got some, he got a couple.
No, he don't, bro. Yeah, this nigga can't rap.
Make it rap.
All he say is stupid. And
That's just
Blicky with the sticky or whatever that nigga say.
I mean, he
to be honest with you, the only song that the only 6ix9ine song I ever listened to was
the one with Nicki.
Get no, fuck that. I don't listen to Nicki Minaj.
What?
It was get the strap with 50.
That's what I'm saying,
6ix9ine,
man.
Uncle Murder.
Listen to yourself.
But Uncle Murder can rap though. I love the wrap up every year.
That's what I'm saying. You get 6ix9ine got to the point where he got Uncle Murder, 50 Cent, and Casanova on his music.
But before, I just knew he was a troll.
That's outside the music.
But I don't think anything 6ix9ine did musically. You can say helped Griselda Records be successful. Because them niggas been rapping. They've been popping.
Yeah, they ain't been popping. They've been rapping.
In Buffalo.
That's what I'm saying. But when New York, 6ix9ine was one of the first rappers of this generation to really bring back that grimy sound to New York.
What?
Who else?
I thought Pop Smoke did that.
He's before Pop Smoke. 6ix9ine is before all that. When 6ix9ine did it, then everybody started coming back to the grime stuff. And I'm not saying that he was directly, but his influence of the grime let Griselda B have a light on them. Cause he was just the grime. They were the grime with the lyrics. And 6ix9ine can rap, man. That's why everybody's like, man, you ain't gotta do all that, cause you can rap. You can make good songs.
I saw the little doc with how he started out. He really went on that shit. Like, he walked around with shirts that said nigga and all of that for attention.
Yeah.
But I feel like Griselda on the pops because they're like, Griselda ain't doing shit. They ain't doing nothing that no Southern artists hadn't been doing 10 years ago.
Yeah, exactly.
I feel like they saw Dipset and was like, that's how they are. They're Dipset. They're Dipset remix.
Yeah, they're a group of rappers. But what I'm saying is that there were other rappers who were in that vein of, you know, grime that were put in a category. And 6ix9ine catapulted to where he put a light on that type of rap again in New York. And after that, it turned into, like, you said it yourself. If you got 50, Casanova, and Uncle Murder on a song, people go their whole careers in New York and don't have them three on the same song.
I thought 50 only attached itself to the young nigga because he was hot.
I agree. But it's a bunch of hot rappers you don't fuck with. In fact, 50 is the main one to see a hot rapper and talk down on him and shoot slugs at him. That's his M.O. Make fun of you. You know.
Well, I ain't going to. The little nigga had a buzz.
He had a super buzz.
He was the hottest nigga in New York, man.
That's what I'm saying. But you don't become the hottest nigga in New York the way he was and be all good.
I, Hold on.
Yeah.
I thought Bobby Smurda started it.
I was more. I think Hot Nigga was a hood song.
Hot Nigga was better than anything I heard 6ix9ine put up.
Nah, Gummo go hard in the bitch, man.
Who?
Gummo.
When he was dissing the Trippy Red Nigga.
Nah, Gummo is I can't say the song, man, because
I never heard it. I'm gonna lie to you.
Gummo was the one where he was in front of the house with all the Bloods. Gummo go hard, bro. He got
I've heard of the song. I've heard that's the song that, like, you know, catapulted him.
Yeah, it's good. Gummo go
hard,
bro.
But I thought Bobby Smurda had already been hot and then just went to jail.
But you, so what I'm saying, you
like, how long Bobby Smurda been sitting down?
7 years. So that's what I'm saying.
He was hot 7 years ago.
Yeah, and so was 6ix9ine.
I heard 6ix9ine like about 2.5 years ago.
6ix9ine was probably, you know, I'm not an official.
The first thing I heard about the nigga was he was fucking with little kids.
Well, no, the first thing I heard about him, man, he was giving money to kids. That's the first time I ever saw him, he was giving money to kids. He going to schools and, like, telling the kids, y'all do good, and giving them 50s and 20s. This is like 5-6 years ago. You know what I mean? That's the first thing. I was like, who is this dude and why is he able to do this? And I wasn't really feeling it because I was like, man, that's kind of like, but long story short, you know, he got 6ix9ine, man. 6ix9ine, You have to give him credit. You can't discredit him. And all that being said, that's why I'm saying, like, what makes 6ix9ine not be able to have a Grammy? Or maybe he does.
I don't know if he does or doesn't, but yeah. I feel like if he wouldn't have got jammed up and went through the bullshit he had just went through, he probably would still be as hot as he was.
Yeah, yeah. And another thing, I don't want to talk about Meggy, man. I mean, congratulations, man. But to me, it's like, I just wonder about what it says about the way we see, the way, I mean, because I don't want to be like, women got to be better. And a woman going to say,
what do you mean better?
Like, we didn't see the performance.
Well, let me ask you a real question.
Yeah.
Why is it that Megan is championed as, like, one of the hottest females?
Yeah.
Cardi's the hottest female rapper.
Yeah.
I'm not going to throw Nicki in there, because Nicki can actually rap.
Yeah.
But Rhapsody raps better than 98% of these niggas rap.
Rhapsody.
So why Rhapsody don't get the love she should get? Did she win a Grammy?
She got nominated last year, I believe, but she didn't win.
Layla's Wisdom should have won at least two Grammys. And that's not even the last one she put out.
No. I think the reason why Rhapsody doesn't get the love she get is simple. I'm not gonna say what I usually say.
But, yeah, don't say niggas is
But I was saying, like, if you look at it, man, like, do you really feel like the best rapper in your city is the most popular rapper in your city? Any city you could think of. Uh-oh, got him. Got him on the wrong hole. if I was like to say the best rapper in Houston, right? The most lyrical rapper in Houston is not always the best rapper in Houston. If I was say Dallas, if I was going to say Atlanta, if I was going to say New York, the most lyrical rapper is not the best rapper, or not considered the best rapper most of the time. It's because, you know, I'm going to put it on my ladies on this one, because women they consume music differently than men, right? And a woman will tell you in a heartbeat, like, I just like the beat. I don't care what they're saying.
Yeah, but
So now.
But Rhapsody the complete package though.
Yeah.
Because that production they got over there at TDE is fire. And then, bro, I've heard Rhapsody out rap Kendrick.
Yeah.
And I've also heard
Rhapsody signed to J label.
She over there with TDE too.
Yeah,
she over there with Top Dog and all
that. But the thing is, what I'm saying is Rhapsody has lyricism. And so I've sat with several people, women and men, and they'll hear a song and not really catch what's going on in the song. Not catch the double entendres, not catch the all the wordplay, not understand what's going on, and just be bobbing their head.
Rhapsody gets Scarface, Nas, Conway the Machine.
Mm-hmm.
Action with me and my iTunes. I don't have to hear not one single off the song. If I see Rhapsody got a project out,
yeah,
I'm in download.
I'm glad you said Nas, because Nas won our best album of the year, and I was kind of upset about that, because this last album might have been one of Nas's, I wouldn't say worst, but this is not Nas. Ooh, Nas.
This last album was the best of the latest that he's put out.
I, you know what?
Only because he got away. Nah,
I totally disagree.
Kanye fucked up. What
Damn,
you call?
I'm like, look, this is okay. I'm gonna have to say it. I don't want to say it,
this
man.
This is the equivalent of I'm giving James Harden the MVP because he should have won it 2 years in a row.
Nah,
and I'm giving it to him for this year. That's what this is.
Watch,
because he should have been at a Grammy.
Look, when the Kanye album came out, right? The Kanye Knowledge produced album came out,
right?
People were mad at Kanye. So they said some shit about they didn't give Nas his note. In September, the same year, Nas dropped a visual.
Yeah.
Didn't say it was from, he just said, I'm dropping a visual album.
Right.
It was the exact same album. The exact same album that he did with Kanye. And people praised it out. They're like, oh man, it's the same. Because
this is the thing with that though. From my understanding, the albums that Ye put out then, it wasn't the albums that they, it wasn't the album they wanted. They recorded one album and they thought it was one way. Kanye put out something different.
Yeah. Same what does that matter?
Same thing with Teyana Taylor.
That's a lie.
That's what they say. Teyana Taylor say she got mad because that one album I listened to and constructed, you changed some shit.
But
I
think I'm saying the only Nas is sitting, like they got video of Nas and Kanye sitting in Queens on Queens Bridge.
Yeah, surrounded, I saw that.
Banging to the song. And
apparently that was the first time Nas heard that song completely finished.
And he was sitting there banging his head. And
it wasn't a trash album.
Everybody in the Queen Bridge is like,
it wasn't a trash album.
It wasn't it was a great album. It was short.
I think the only person who really did the album they really wanted to do was Pusha T.
And his album to me was overrated.
The
best album out that, I don't want to go too far into Kanye whole, but at that little, that package, the Kid Cudi Kanye album was the best out of that whole package.
I don't fuck Kid Cudi like that.
Okay, but that album was fire though. That I'm not a Kid Cudi fan either, but that album, and this is how I judge my albums, right? I judge albums by the way it makes me feel personally and how other people who don't necessarily like that music react to it. So I know that summer I had clean versions. I'll play it for the kids. And I know it's kids that was word for word with the Kanye Kid, because it was an album. Like the kids were like, and I'm like, if these kids who don't even care for music like that are on it, then I'm like, okay, he got
that's
something.
That's the one with the Slick Rick flip, right? Like the cops tried to kick.
That's Nas. Nice. Yeah. That's why I'm saying it had some hard. And then
it had some bangers.
And then Nas, they were mad because Kanye went harder than Nas on that track. Kanye went in harder on the than, but you know that's hard. But back to the Grammys and Megan.
That's because Pusha T wrote it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm not going to talk about the writing. That's another thing because I'm looking at these right. I'm like, man, you got 34 people writing your anyway, Megan. But to me, I mean. Congratulations to Megan, man, and I think it's the same way you feel about Kanye, the sentiments you're giving about his albums and how it's not the music that it's not the actual product that we're really judging. You're judging everything around the project, and it's giving you a taste about the project. The same with Megan, her year that she had this year, with her getting shot and all this kind of, is her label problems, that. Is what's fueling the fire for her music, because her music is trash, man. Let's just say, be honest, her shit is not all
there's
that jamming.
Nothing unique about Megan.
Nothing.
So I'll say this, like, Cardi has a uniqueness about her music to me, because I feel like she's selling personality. She sold us a personality before she rapped one song. Everybody knows that Cardi don't write shit.
That's the same with Megan. Megan is selling personality. Point in case
but,
being.
But what I'm saying is, I don't know if you can duplicate Cardi all the way. But this, what was this?
I know you're going to say, keep going.
Everybody had this TikTok challenge going on.
That Erica, whatever.
I thought Banks. That was Meg at first.
And you know who producer?
I know, it's Carl Crawford.
Carl Crawford, you know, so I can make another Megan because, but more power to all of them, whatever, man. But I found it funny. I found it unique.
I'm not a Meg fan, but they're going to say I'm a hater. But, all right, look, so question.
Yeah.
I've been doing some thinking.
Okay.
So I want to revisit a topic we had last week.
All right.
I might have a different outlook.
All right.
I've been just noticing people have been talking about like the Jay-Z deals and shit that.
Ooh,
and then
okay.
They also brought up the Swizz and Timbaland deal with Versus.
All right.
And so they were talking about, this is my first thing. You know, people criticize the deals. Jay shouldn't have sold this, that, and the third. It ain't black owned no more.
Yeah.
He sold 50% to the guy, you know, to Square Inc. or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And now, you know, he owns 50%. Mm-hmm. And so you hear like the Hovengers. I call them the Hovengers. Joe Budden podcast.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, of course, it's Maul. Maul is, you know, Maul is. Yeah, he
pro Jay-Z.
He Rockefeller, by family.
Yeah.
Rory works for Rockefeller.
Okay.
Joe Budden was on Rockefeller. I never understood why Joe Budden gives Jay so much credit, bro. But whatever.
Yeah.
It is what it is.
Yeah.
So they were just saying like, oh yeah, niggas is dumb.
Yeah.
Because they were talking about the deal
and
how, you know, people say, oh, it's a bad deal. You sold, you know, title to this nigga or whatever.
Yeah.
And then you hear people saying, well, no black people work for title. Because you remember, like, back in when he first bought it, that photo came out, and it was him, Beyonce, and a bunch of white people.
Yeah, exactly.
And then, like, you hear people like Charlamagne, you hear people like Joe Budden, they're like, oh, man. Hey, you know, title black as fuck.
Yeah.
Because when you go to the Roc Nation office,
yeah,
the one floor that's title is nothing but black people.
Okay.
We don't see that.
We don't. But,
the common public doesn't see that. So, my thing is, you know, you want to call people crazy and stupid.
Yeah.
And then say, oh, y'all stupid. Y'all never done a multi-million dollar business deal before. Like, okay. I feel like 98% of the population has never done that.
I agree.
So educate us. Tell us what it means. Like, how come, I get it, it's his business. He can do whatever the fuck he wants to with it.
Okay.
But there's no education process to it.
All right.
There's no sitting down and seeing people are invested in you because you have this mm-hmm. title that I'm invested in. It's black owned. It's a black owned streaming program.
Yeah, I agree.
Let me buy into it. Now you sell it. I don't understand. You'll sell out.
See, okay. I just had this conversation a couple of days ago, right?
But what I'm saying is, how come we don't know? We don't know what the title floor looks like because we've never seen photos of it.
This is where I'm going to go. Are you pro Jay-Z or anti Jay-Z in this?
I'm not pro or anti Jay-Z. And I'm going to tell you, I'm not pro or anti Jay-Z. Yeah. And I'm going to tell you why. I want to know, I want to learn more. Because I hear, on one end, I'm looking at it like this.
Yeah.
I'm looking at Dame Dash.
Yeah.
He has his situation going on. And it's 100% him. Yeah. I hear Dame Dash talk about, if you ain't putting no money up, you just working for somebody.
You a sucker.
You a sucker. And then I hear Joe Budden and Maul criticize Charlamagne for partnering with iHeartRadio with the Black Effect podcast. They'll criticize him. And they'll say, oh, partnership. Yeah, you just working for the man. But then they'll champion Jay-Z for what he did. Okay. And then they'll criticize, you know what I'm saying, like Charlamagne, like, oh, yeah, you a sucker for partnering with iHeart. Yeah, we said fuck Spotify.
Yeah.
So, but then you hear them get on there and champion it like, oh, what's wrong with him selling 50% of it? He's partnering with people to get on the board and be all this shit to open up doors for more black people.
Okay.
But what doors is he opening up for black people outside of selling half of his? Yeah, he opened up some, he put money in 19 pockets of the artists that were on that deal with him.
Yeah.
Yes, he's on a board with Cash App and all the other stuff.
Yeah.
What is that going to do for us? Because we didn't even know what buying title did for us because we never saw black faces employed for title.
Okay.
You get what I'm saying? Because I feel like it's something about representation. Prime example.
I'm going to say prime example.
And okay. I don't know. This might not even make sense. Niggas might think I'm tripping or I'm stupid.
Okay.
But back in the day.
Yeah.
When we watched the Cosby Show and we watched A Different World,
okay, yeah,
niggas wanted to go to college because they saw black faces being represented at college doing something positive.
Okay, yeah,
we wanted to do it.
Yeah,
but when you see stuff like Tidal, or when you see stuff like Gucci, or when you see stuff like Nike,
yeah,
I don't see black faces being represented as
in a positive way.
It's not positive or negative.
I just
don't see like workers or like I didn't know how black Tidal was because I've never seen
a photo or video
of a bunch of black people employed by Tidal.
I don't think it is black. I think that the bitch might be black, but as a whole, I don't think it's black. But
you know what I've seen black as fuck?
What?
No Limit or anything Master P got going on. You want to know why?
Because he shows you.
But,
okay, so this is my thing. This is my thing with the Jay-Z thing, right? So my whole thing is like, if you're going to preach legacy and tell us about how we should, you know, empower ourselves to be owners, be bosses, be leaders, all that kind of stuff. Well, being to me, I look at, okay, what do other industries do? What do other cultures, races, people do, right?
Mm-hmm.
Sears Roebuck is not selling out to nobody. Sears Roebuck might downsize, might do, but they're going to keep the Sears Roebuck name going,
mm-hmm.
and they're going to employ their people. If the whole goal is to create a company to sell it, then you're not really leaving a legacy of nothing. But for you as an individual, And even though you might plant seeds in 19 individuals or the people that in your immediate future, like, they're still converts. Converts ain't selling out. Converts might merge with Nike, but they're gonna keep. They keep businesses. And the way I look at it, I look at all the businesses that are legacy businesses around the country.
But I guess in a way though, because he did that, because he still has 50% of title, so he still has it's still him. He still has control over title.
From when I read the deal first, just like with the Nets when he came in, he was a piece of the pie. He was never title was around before Jay-Z.
No, it was. He just bought it. I think Jay-Z bought title. He bought a streaming service for 50, 60 million, whatever the number was.
Yeah.
He bought the streaming title. And then I know he sold like 3% of it to T-Mobile or something to do a deal.
Yeah.
And then apparently he bought that 3% back.
Yeah.
Before he did the deal with Square.
Okay.
Now, he only sold 50%, I think. So he still owns 50% of title. So he still had, so I guess it's like, I still own 50% of title.
Yeah. But why am I still doing that,
I still make decisions.
Yeah.
He sold it to Square from what I hear the whole Avengers say. Yeah. He sold it to Square. So now he's on a board. Of Square.
Yeah.
Which means he's on the board of Square. I think he has some shit, Cash App, Twitter, all that shit now. It's the seat at the table they keep talking about.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is, to me, it's like I said, and this, I'm going to stay with you, but I'm going to veer off to where I always go with it. There's no black restaurants, chains, throughout the country. There's no black grocery stores. There's no black shoe stores. There's no black shoe company. There's no black t-shirt company. There's no
I don't think you say there isn't any. Is there something we don't know about?
There's no, that's what I'm saying.
Like you talking about like major chain?
I'm talking about why, like.
Like there's no black owned version of Nike, if that's the thing.
Yeah,
where do you go?
Why, like, I get on athletes, let's say James Harden. James Harden, Adidas gives you $300 million for an 11-year deal. In year 11, man. Why are you signing back with Adidas? Why would I go back to if they gave me $300 million before I did anything, before I got any MVPs? Y'all gave me $300 million.
Essentially, that's what Dwayne Wade did, though, right?
He went to Li Ling.
But it's Wave by Ling Ling or whatever it's called.
Yeah, he's still signing somebody else. Like, why? If you give me enough money, $300 million after taxes, $150 million. Why am I going back to re-sign with you when I really, in essence, can go and start my own company?
Because you're saying LeBron is the brand. So LeBron doesn't need Nike.
I don't need Nike. You're saying Converse.
LeBron can do what some of these guys like Saya is. I don't know if you heard of Saya, whatever his name is. But he's like a New York guy that lives in Oakland.
Okay.
Makes his own like luxury tennis shoe.
Ball did. And everybody got on the ass for that, but like that's the like why wouldn't I make my own shit? Why am I so attached to these companies that's not attached to me? Because if I turn my finger up, they ain't giving me shit.
I think the guys who probably could do it don't like Jordan don't need Nike.
Yeah, but even Jordan said I got Jordan brand, so we're tied together because we got tied together before. It wasn't a common knowledge or even just a normal thing for somebody to just like to break off. But at this point,
because essentially Jordan and Nike was like the first of that bullshit going on.
Yeah, he was one.
To that height.
Yeah, yeah, he was one of the. He was probably
like niggas have shoe deals because of Jordan.
Exactly.
In a certain
exactly. Okay. So why? But why not? Why like? And it's been done before, and we've seen it be successful. We've seen the Starberries. We've seen FUBUs.
Well, but boys ain't want to wear Starberries because there's $9. But I think that was the beauty of it.
But boys wore. But people would say they want to wear them, but he sold out.
That was a quality $9 shoe, bro.
Yeah, what I'm saying, we saw it with FUBU. Starberry got bought out. He didn't sell out. You can still buy Starberries online. FUBU sold out. Like, why is it that every time we get a company that is that could be something like that can be a star mark or something that can grow. We don't. It doesn't get to grow. Why is that?
But I think there's something to be said about knowing when your run is up. Let me cash out.
Why is your run
because,
up?
Because
why would your run be up?
I think the FUBU shit kind of got dated though, like Iceberg and all that shit. But it kind of just went out of style.
Watch this.
But he cashed out.
You know why it went out of style? Because he cashed out and it went out of style. It didn't go down. He sold it when at its peak. They sold out.
All right, explain this to me.
Yeah, same with Tidal.
Timbaland. And
why am I selling? Like, why do I create something, bring it to the heights I can bring it to, and then give it to some white people?
Honestly, I think Versus has run its course, and I think they cashed out.
It's never gonna run its course, man. This goes back to my thinking. Like, for some,
outside from the open though, niggas
it
ain't
matter.
That shit was live matter. Because niggas was inside and there was nothing else to do. And they had this Versus battle. So now I'm locked in the house.
Okay.
I have nothing else to do.
Yeah.
Man, these niggas finna go, you know, like yeah. a little song for song battle. So, well, now shit is opening up. Concert venues are finna be open in a month
matter.
Or two.
So you think that they sold something to a company that's gonna make a whole TV show out this shit?
Mm-hmm.
They finna make a whole TV show out this shit. They finna cash it out too. They ain't finna pay you this money so they can lose money. You know what I'm saying? They finna make money off it too. You could do the same thing. You could do the exact same thing. And once again, FUBU. What? FUBU.
So let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Why is it when we was rapping?
Mm-hmm.
If you take the mindset you take right now, mm-hmm. why is it when we were rapping, our goal was to get signed to a major?
Because we know no better.
I'm not gonna say that. I'm gonna say signing to that major. Got us in places that we couldn't get ourselves at the top.
At the time, so but once we get to the major, and we get the money, if we keep reading up with the major, at some point it has to be a 50-50 deal. It can't keep being we sign. It gotta be shit. This is 50-50 or this is 75-25 because we are the product. You label didn't make us. You labeled us have access that we don't have, but now we have that access. They know who the Migos are.
And,
they know who the so-and-so
and
are.
So that brings me back to my point. Well, I think. Some people, they don't know. They don't know mm-hmm. when Swiss do the deal, what it actually does. So you got one hand of people saying, y'all niggas is dumb. Y'all selling out, this, that, and the third.
That's all it can be, though, bro.
But, but it's not, though.
It has to be.
I think it is something. I think there's something to say, this deal gets me on the board. It gets me into places I can't go.
Well, what
it makes me bigger than what I could have been.
What I'm saying is, and this is going to go all the way back to my original Grammys conversation. Because what my question was, why the fuck do the Grammys even matter?
The Grammys matter because the industry said it does matter.
But
you know what? The BET Awards should matter more to us
than the Grammys.
Than
exactly.
The Grammys.
But we, our heroes, our people that we admire.
The Grammys was the ball.
Keep giving them. And the Grammys has showed. The Grammys was so racist, they had to have talks with, like, hey, man, you guys are racist, man. Y'all are ignoring an entire sector of music. Y'all not even airing the rap on y'all. You know what I'm saying? This is not a hunt. This is. The first rap winner didn't even get to perform.
You want to know what the real problem is?
What's that?
If you go to Meyerland in Houston.
Yeah.
What is Meyerland?
It's heavily Caucasian.
No, but what else is Meyerland?
Rich, very rich.
But what else is Meyerland?
It's
a Jewish community.
Okay, there you go, yeah.
So when you go to Meyerland.
Yeah.
I know back when I was younger, you go to Meyerland.
Yeah.
One no black corner stores over there. One no Asian corner stores over there. One no,
it
was strictly just Jewish.
Yeah, it still ain't.
You know what I'm
saying?
It was their community.
Yeah,
and they had big Meyerland, bro. The fucking outdoor mall was owned by a Jewish family.
Yes, Meyerland. Yeah,
you take that, and to me, stuff like the Grammys. Even spot certain shit in Hollywood, it's for them. It ain't for us.
And the shit that we have for us,
we won't go to it. Like black people would champion Jay-Z, Beyonce, all, you know what I'm saying, Rihanna, all of these stars.
Yeah.
We'll champion the shit out of them.
Yeah.
Give them awards and acknowledgments at BET that I ain't gonna say they don't deserve, but these niggas won't even show up for it.
I'm with you.
But they'll show up.
for the Grammys.
Beyonce and Jay-Z was front line at the Grammys last night,
they
right?
They were very much sitting right
will
there.
Will they front. Be front line at the BET Awards?
I hope so.
As black as Jay-Z is now.
With his dreads and everything.
Will he be front line at the BET Awards?
I hope so. But what I'm talking about, even what I'm saying is, to an extent, it's like we shape the culture of the world in so many aspects. So why are we still asking for permission, asking for acceptance from the people who are the very people who are oppressing us? Point. I have a point to make. One point. Somebody was saying they want to throw a party at a city park that's in a neighborhood that's been recently gentrified, right?
Right.
So their house is literally, their house is, the park is behind their house.
Mm-hmm.
City park behind their house. There is a 60-foot mural of their grandmother on the wall of the house.
Mm-hmm.
That was commemorating this woman as the first lady of First Ward.
Right.
Right. They want to throw a gala or an event in that park for her, the people who are from the neighborhood. And they were worried if the neighbors would call the police because they didn't have a permit to be in that park.
And the neighbors are people who are not even of that community.
Of that community.
They don't even know the history of the community.
Exactly.
They don't even realize the significance of that young lady who's on the wall.
Exactly. So my whole thing is, why are we caring if they do that? I'm going to throw whatever I want in my neighborhood, and you can go call whoever you want to, and then I want the world to see how you really are. But
that's because we don't own anything.
And
we don't have any ownership.
And that's why I'm saying, why am I selling my companies off?
So I don't think there's anything wrong with necessarily partnering or selling some companies off.
We don't own shit.
My thing is this. How come, and I don't know, this might sound ignorant, instead of him selling 50% to Square, why couldn't Tidal acquire more shit?
Why can't I just keep going and keep bubbling and make this a staple, make this something like has Universal ever sold their shares?
You know what it felt like to me? It felt like a cash out. To me, it felt like 50-plus-year-old Jay is like, hey, you know what? I'm cashing out. So I sell 50% of Tidal. I sell 50% of Ace of Spades.
Yeah.
And I'm cashing out. And I'm almost at $1 billion in 2 weeks, and I'm good.
But that's what I'm saying. And this is why.
Because I don't know what his seat at the table means. Because apparently he had a seat at the table with the NFL 2 years ago. I don't know what the fuck it is done.
To me, like I said, and I hate to be.
He gave us some concerts with J-Lo and.
Shakira.
J-Lo, Shakira, and what's that nigga name, bro?
Daddy Yankee?
Nah, that this past one.
Bad Bunny?
Nah.
It wasn't no black person.
This past Super Bowl, yes, it was. What's the nigga
name?
Oh,
The Weeknd?
Yeah, The Weeknd.
Yeah. I don't understand.
And see, this nigga's going to say we hating Jay-Z.
That's what I'm saying. I don't
understand how you are in charge of Super Bowl entertainment and the Super Bowl is in Atlanta.
Atlanta. First, it was in Miami the first time.
No. It was in Atlanta when he told niggas not to perform when he was trying to get the deal.
Yeah.
Because he was mad at Travis. He told Travis Scott not to perform, yes, right?
Exactly, yeah.
And don't fuck with the NFL.
Yeah.
But that's because he was trying to get a deal with the NFL.
Yeah.
Got a deal with the NFL.
Yeah.
Super Bowl in Miami.
Yeah. Didn't put his artist that he helped cultivate, Rick Ross, on the. But I'm just saying, in general, forget the Jay-Z factor.
You should have heard Port of Miami.
Or Hustling, at least.
Every damn. That should have dropped.
You know, but. As far as ownership, like, we don't own anything. So if we don't own anything, we're in a land that the laws are literally set up for us not to own against us. So why should our mindset be, I'm going to build a company up to sell it? Then you ain't going to never own. You're going to have a bunch of money and you don't have the power. You can be $1 billion strong, but if you don't have ownership, you still paying extra to get everything.
Pretty sure he still has some. So I'll say this.
Yeah.
I don't understand how a multi-million dollar business deal works. I'm not even gonna sit here and act like I understand
it. That's beyond. I know one.
But I'm saying it has to be some significance of being able to be on that board. If they say this, but my thing is this.
All right. But so what?
But fuck I look that at this. Board, I look at. Well, you can't say that.
Yes, because they built the board the same way that they built the board through unification and they united. Why can't we have Jay-Z, Master P?
Well, that's the problem. We don't work together.
Exactly. Everything that points everything. I can look at other communities and look how they grew and how they.
I feel like I feel like between Jay, Puff, Dame, Master P,
yeah,
Dre, Dr. Dre,
yeah,
between them five, we should be able to have some sort of streaming platform, hardware platform,
something.
It's the reason why I don't fuck with Tidal. I don't have Tidal on my phone.
Yeah,
it has nothing to do with Jay-Z. Mm-hmm. It has everything to do with the fact that my iTunes mm-hmm. is full of music that I've accumulated over years.
Mm-hmm.
It financially made no sense.
Yeah,
to go pay Tidal X yeah. amount of dollars a month.
Yeah,
when I'm already invested in iTunes.
But I mean, I have Tidal, and I think the thing I didn't have Tidal first. I had Deezer, but to me, it's the access. Just because I'm not trying to save nothing, I might save a playlist or two. But for me, I'm like, I want to have access to all this music. When I think in my head, I want to hear blank song, I can type it in his mind. I can listen to it.
I have Apple MacBook. I have Apple PC. Yeah. I have Apple TV.
I
have Apple speakers.
Yeah.
I have all this Apple hardware. And the thing that works seamlessly with my Apple hardware is iTunes.
Yeah, iTunes, yeah. That's by design.
It made no sense for me to fuck with Tidal.
That's by design. 100%.
It is by design. But I'm saying, I'll be fucking with the Atlanta owned shit, with Atlanta based shit, the Buy Black type shit. It's a website I fuck with.
Yeah.
And they have all kind of shit. They got like black owned cell phone services. You know what I'm saying? They got black owned laundry detergent, shit like that.
Yeah.
Out of these five guys, you mean to tell me that we can't get a hardware company where we can go get our own phone. And then we can like have like that shit proprietary stuff where boom, title on there. Boom, Beats by Dre worked perfect with the shit.
Yeah, yeah.
I almost saw like Beats by Dre and Apple. He sold Beats by Dre and Apple, whatever. Like,
that's what I'm saying.
I get it. But you mean to tell me we can't come together and have something?
Exactly. It starts with ownership. It starts, if we don't own nothing, we can't come together because we don't, like, it's a perfect example. In order for us to come together and do something, we got to have something to come together with. If we're not coming together, and if you don't have something, I got something, he got something, if every time we get up to a certain moment, we just sell out to somebody else, how am I coming to you with something?
Like, I never, and that takes me back to the podcasting scene. I never understand why it seemed like Joe Budden and Charlamagne beefing. When the Joe Budden Network and the Black Effect Podcast Network, it's the same shit. You literally have the same talent.
Mm-hmm.
Having shows on both platforms.
Mm-hmm.
I listen to the Horrible Decisions podcast from time to time.
Mm-hmm.
Bro, Horrible Decisions is on Black Effect.
Okay.
But then Mandy B has a whole nother podcast on the Joe Budden Network.
Yeah, okay.
Bro, I heard her say that it sounds like it. She said, I feel like I'm signed to Death Row and Bad Boy at the same time.
Yeah.
Bro, that's crazy.
I can see it, man. To me, like I said, at the end of the day.
But I feel like if them two guys came together.
Yeah.
I think Joe Budden is probably the hottest, one of the hottest niggas in podcasting.
Yeah, easily.
And then Charlamagne is one of the hottest niggas on radio that crosses over to podcast. Them niggas just had rap beef because, Breakfast Club won Best Podcast on iHeart at the iHeart Awards. Yeah. And they's not even podcast, it's radio stuff. Like, dude, why does it matter? I don't understand why Joe Budden, Charlamagne can't come together and have their own network and partner up with Spotify or partner up with iHeart or partner up with iTunes, something like that.
Ego. That's why. Ego.
What you got next?
Okay. So, which you want to go? Kirk Franklin or you want to go boxing?
Man, I heard the Kirk Franklin shit, bro, and it sounded like a parent who ain't trying to hear they grown son tell them to shut the fuck up talking to them, bro.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I understand it. To me, I think that it's like we can't normalize. That's what we've done. And this goes, this is in the same vein.
Hey, I'm going to say it, man. 33-year-old nigga is a whole ass nigga for taping his old man, bro.
Very much so. But in the same breath, like, if you 33 and you 60-something, your son is 30-something, right?
How old is Kirk Franklin, by the way?
He got to be 60% 33.
He ain't got to be, but I got you, though.
But you telling me that at this age, it's how you communicate? This is how you communicate at this age? Like, we normalize violence. We normalize aggression so much in our community that when shit like this happens, we're like, oh, she just mad. Or, you know, but to me, I'm like,
you got kids. Your daughter tell you to shut the fuck up talking to her. What you going to say?
At 13?
At 33.
At 33? At 33, I would just hope that we don't even talk like that to each other. But if she did, I hope that I would be able to, like, tell her, like, why would you say that to me? That's so probably what I would say.
My parents are like 65 and 67.
Yeah.
I wouldn't dare tell them to shut the fuck up talking to me.
I wouldn't even do it. So it's hard for me. It's hard for me.
Yeah.
But in the same breath, what I'm saying is that
I probably would get a similar response, if not worse.
My daughter, when she was a baby, when she was 1, 2, and 3, right? And she would cry, I would know. I know for a fact that a bunch of parents, when they cry, be like, what, be quiet, shut up, whatever. Or spank them.
I hate that.
Know what I would do? I would pick her up and take her to the mirror and say, look at yourself. Is that how you want to look? Is this you right here?
I hate parents to curse out young kids, but if you're 33 years old and you acting like the whole ass nigga he was acting.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not. I don't understand what people expect, bro.
But I'm not saying. All I'm saying is that I'm not trying to damn or talk down or say he was wrong. I'm just saying that the mentality that we have as a people, as a culture, to normalize it, to be like, oh, that's what you get for doing that. To me, I'm like, nah, there's a better way of if he's saying that, you know what, son, you're going through something right now, and I'll talk to you when you can talk to me. Like you know, I don't have to. Every time you punch in the face, you ain't got
to off the street tell you to shut the fuck up talking to them.
Once again, it's ego, man. It's ego and pride, man.
Hey, man.
It's ego and pride.
My 33-year-old son can't tell me to shut the fuck up talking to him.
I'm going to be like, you know what?
All right, that's what's up. I'll be over there so you can tell me to shut the fuck up talking to you.
See, I don't know. All I'm saying is that it's ego and pride. And for years and years, as a people, all we've had is ego and pride. That's all we've had. We don't, back to what you said, we don't own shit. We don't have shit to call our own. So what do we have? The famous words of Scarface, all I got is my boss and my word, and I stand on those.
It's nothing wrong with having ego and pride, though.
If it controls you, yeah, it is.
What you mean? But how are you saying it's controlled this man, bro?
If,
from my understanding, the son been a problem son.
Yeah.
You know what it sounds like?
Exactly.
It sounds like
So you still doing this?
It sounds like he just a spoiled ass nigga.
And you still doing it? And so you telling me you've been a problem son as long as I've, and for 33 years, and I'm still getting this hype over you?
Because he probably loves his son, so he's trying to help him out.
Mm-hmm.
And the son probably on some bullshit.
Yeah. Once again, so you telling me
you a whole ass nigga for recording your dad?
Very, it's very weak.
Cause you know who your father is.
Yes,
and my father knows
who he is.
But you know, once you drop this recording of Kirk Franklin, you know, talking to you like Plies, you already know that he going, oh man, you was supposed to be a Christian. You know what I'm saying?
Didn't know Kirk Franklin was from Fort Worth, Texas.
Well, it makes sense then. If you're from Funkatown, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, see,
makes sense then.
Which makes me think, that's why I always felt a certain kind of way about him. I'm like, man, I don't know about this guy. But anyway, I just think, I'm not saying he's wrong. I'm not judging him. I'm just saying that, honestly, there's a better way to handle a situation.
We shouldn't
normalize and high-five the nigga for doing all
that. Well, I'm not. And I agree. Like, I feel like I can't. I don't have any kids, but I got nieces and nephews. And I feel like in talking to them, even when they fuck up, me talking to them like a nigga on the street ain't gonna get my point across because it's someone I love.
Yeah.
Problem is up with me and you.
Yeah.
Me and you done got into it plenty of times.
Yeah.
I'm not handling you like the average nigga on the street.
I'm not old bitch ass nigga.
Because Kirk Franklin
was a bitch ass
nigga. Oh, well, he's a bitch ass
nigga. Yeah, that's like, hold up. Ooh.
But I'm saying, like, you know, I love my brother Boog, so hey man, you tripping, bro. I ain't gonna call you bitch ass
nigga. Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
Bullshit.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And at the end of the day, if it get to that point, we gonna, you know, I'm talking to you another time, man. You know, we're gonna end it.
End it.
But that's what I'm saying. So you telling me, and this is where it gets funky. You a man of the cloth. This is what you preach. This is what you preach. This is what you preach.
That's my thing. He a man of the cloth, but he's still human just like us.
What I'm saying is you
why do we hold men of the cloth at a higher standard than we hold ourselves?
We hold anybody who holds a position of leadership higher than we, because if I can't give you a role of leadership if you're not going to do leadership shit. If you're a fireman, if you're a policeman, if you're a coach, if you're a teacher, if you're a singer, if I give you this accolade to say, oh, I praise you for your talents, I also expect you to give me more. Now, sometimes we put the wrong people, like, for instance, singers. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is my problem with Meg Thee Stallion, my problem with Cardi B, my problem with these women that say that they're role models. It's like, how are you a role model for little girls, and look what you're presenting to little girls? That's my only issue.
You can't say that out loud. They're going to say that we're being sexist.
That's my only issue. That's my only issue.
I feel like I can't say, hey, we need to uplift black women, and then you drop wet-ass pussy.
That's what I'm saying. And that's my only issue.
But
Not that they drop it, but I'm saying that
I like the song.
No, I'm saying, ain't about the song. The song, I don't like the song, but ain't about the song being wet. I'm saying that you ain't got no alternative. All you got, that's like if when Too Short comes out with bitch, 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 but then he comes out with the ghetto. When 2 Live Crew comes out with, you know, excuse me, Me So Horny, they have there's an alternative song as well on this album that talks about the hardships of growing up in the hood or the being beat as a kid. There's alternatives. It's not just because all you heard was Bitch Make Me Rich. Too Short has the ghetto. Scarface has Dear Diary. You know, there's a roundness, a full-sided picture that's letting me know, yeah, you're an artist. Mm-hmm. You are actually doing something. But in today's market, it's so incorporated by white people who see a niche and like, okay, Cardi B, you're going to be sexy all the fucking time. We're going to exploit your sexiness all the time. Megan Thee Stallion, you're going to shake your ass at every, and even though there's a Carl Crawford here, the big company says, give us more of this. Make it sound more black. Make it sexier. They come in and put their finger on it. They just sent their boss over, put a plug in your ear, and now you crossover on MTV, but they don't care. They'll have a new nigga next year.
Oh, this nigga rapping.
That's Ice Cube, man.
Yeah, I know. This nigga rapping.
Yeah, man. But he was talking some real shit. Mm-hmm. You know, you're out in the cold, no more white fans and no more soul. And you might have a heart attack when you find out the black folks don't want you back. And you know what's worse? You was just like the nigga in the first verse.
You know what I heard a nigga say, bro?
What?
And I think it goes back to the question you asked. You asked me last week why rock and roll didn't have the same violence that hip hop has.
Okay.
And I forgot what I was listening to.
Yeah.
So I can't credit this person for saying what they said.
Okay.
But essentially, there was a question that was asked, and it was similar to that. I think it was like, I forgot the context of the question. Mm-hmm. But make a long story short, the conclusion to the conversation was,
yeah,
in hip-hop,
yeah,
the difference between hip-hop artists and other artists,
yeah,
is that in hip hop, the artists are the only ones who don't realize that they're just, oh, that's what it was. Mm-hmm. The difference between WWE and rap.
Mm-hmm.
And the difference is the WWE talent understands that they're just playing a role. And they talked about how, like, Undertaker, when he went out to eat dinner with his family, nigga was still being role. He'll still be Undertaker.
Yeah.
Because he understood that was a role that he was playing.
Yeah.
Niggas in hip hop don't understand, like the rappers and whatever, they don't understand it. They're just playing a role.
Exactly.
They're the only ones that don't understand they're playing a role.
Yeah.
And that goes back to why the violence is
each other. And now we say that.
But that goes back to why and you made a valid point that we don't have the same
issues.
Like rock and roll don't have the same issues the rap has. The country don't have the same issues the rap has.
Yeah.
Because them niggas don't understand it. They're playing a role. And it's funny to me because hip hop is full of a bunch of real niggas.
Yes.
Who acting.
Yes.
Like, just us rapping, yes. Just us rapping out of Houston, bro.
Yes.
We ran into a bunch of these so-called tough niggas, goons, gangsters.
Yes.
These niggas square. Like, nigga, I went to... I'm not going to name any names.
Mm-hmm.
But I took a class. It was a public speaking class in high school.
Yes.
And in that public speaking class...
Yes. He went to Worth in high school.
It was like six niggas in there who was rappers.
Yes,
legit rappers.
Yes, yes.
I feel like I want a legit rapper. I had just started rapping.
Yeah.
But these niggas legit rappers. Some of them got platinum plaques right now. These are educated. Like, these educated niggas, they know right from wrong. They wasn't selling the dope that they said that they were selling. They wasn't as street as they say they were.
They had jobs at the school.
Real jobs.
They had
not even at school. These niggas did work at Randall's with me.
Yeah, yeah.
So they don't understand they playing a role, and then they take that shit too serious.
And what happens is,
and they don't understand this shit final though. They don't understand how final this shit is, bro.
And then also what happens is they're playing a role, and then you have people who are living in poverty who feel like, okay, if I, to quote the great Sean Carter, if I shoot you, I'm brainless, but if you shoot me, you famous. What's a nigga to do? So that's what it is. I mean, at the end of the day, man, like, it's ego, it's ownership, it's recognition of what's important. And the shit that we thinking is important ain't gonna be important at all.
So when Young Jeezy drop a line and say, I'm the realest nigga in it, is he really the realest nigga in it?
No, absolutely not.
He won Trapper of the Year four times in a row.
He did. He probably did, but he still, like, you know, as I would say, I always tell niggas all the time, like, look, man, you did all this, man. Everything you talking about, all that shit is a terror and a hindrance on your community. You're not going and trapping in River Oaks. You're not going and trapping in Maryland. You're not going and trapping for a bunch of white folks. You trapping to your friends, aunties, uncles, mamas, sisters. You pimping your friends' sisters. You are a menace to society, to your society. And then you turn around and flash flash all the winnings from that in their face and expect to have a long, prosperous life. This is gonna shoot you, bro. This is gonna shoot you in your face, because at some point they realize everything you got was out the backs of my people, man. So why the fuck why would I respect you? Why am I going to give you? Now, everything you got is off the backs of the people that you are flashing your stuff in front of. So at some point, somebody's going to be like, man, fuck this nigga, man. Fuck this nigga, man. He ain't shit. Who was he? He was selling dope to me. He sold dope to my uncle. He shot my homeboy. You are living in your close community and destroying at the same time. But then you want to be, you know, praised. And, oh, yeah, man, you see, shit, yeah, he be pimping them hoes.
But even guys like Rick Ross, I don't know. I don't know if he sold a dope, he said he sold.
Which one?
Not
Freeway?
Not Freeway. We know what he did.
Yeah,
saying, like, the rapper Rick Ross.
Yeah.
Like, he was a correction officer, bro. And it's nothing, honestly, bro.
Nothing wrong with it. But he also, I think Rick Ross wins because his conversation is always always moving forward. So even if he speaks about he was hustling, he's painting a picture, and he paints the picture and he moves forward. So there's always a air of growth in his music.
And I'm not saying there are no real goons in rap.
Yeah, there are a bunch of real goons
in rap. I know some real goons in rap.
There's a bunch of real goons in rap, but
I just think it's more fake niggas in rap than real niggas.
Yeah. And at the end of the day, it's supposed to be art, man. Like, so the goons in rap, to me, like, to me, I'm like, if you feel like you getting it, like, I hate when they say, oh, I got out the streets to get into rap. If you're going to do that, honor that, man.
I got out the streets to get in rap. Rap is the streets, bro.
But it's not though.
It is and it's not.
It's 197% not. Because
for some people,
in all of them, because these niggas is reporting to white folks. Yeah, all the way around, nigga. You got ASCAP, you even reporting to white folks.
Even niggas sell dope reporting to white folks.
You got BMI, you reporting to white folks. So how shrewd is you going to right going down and like, okay, my pseudonym is Young Jeezy. I won't. You know, I got an agent that's like everything you doing is you playing into their role.
So there's no black version of BMI or ASCAP because my and tell me if I'm wrong. My understanding of this shit was just a fucking clearing. It's essentially like a clearinghouse, right?
Basically, yeah.
So what's stopping us from making our own clearinghouse? What's stopping me and you from saying, "Hey, man, we got a Cash Brothers clearinghouse. This is how you get your." How does that shit work?
At the end of the day,
I never understood how my publishing worked. All right, so we rapped. We sent some shit in too. Yeah. I sent it in because we said send that shit in.
Yeah.
I don't know how that works.
You report to the white folks.
Explain to me how if me and you record an album tonight,
mm-hmm.
I want to own my masters.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean?
Owning your masters means that nobody can recreate your work without your permission.
Great. How do I own my masters? So if I record,
mm-hmm.
if we record a song right now.
Yeah.
How I feel like that should be it's my masters. I'm recording on my equipment.
Did you make
my original beat?
Okay.
My original lyrics. Yeah. I wrote them. I created them.
If you did all, if you created the beat and you wrote the words, then
right.
you're the pub and you publish it, meaning publishing means you put it out to the world. So what BMI ASCAP does is they check to see where that music was being reproduced at.
But correct me if I'm wrong. Yeah. We signed up for that and paid a fee.
Yeah, and the fee you paying is to so that they can check to see.
So they're just checking to make sure ain't nobody stealing my shit.
Nobody's using your shit.
Same thing.
Yeah. So BMI's and you got that barcode and all that stuff so that when your song plays on the radio, your song has a tick to it, a digital tick to
it,
or a Wishcow tick to it. So they know, okay, your song played 100 times over here, and they checking that, and it's their job to come back to get the monies and say, okay, it was played 1,000 times. That's 1,000 times, it's the fuck part, 1,000 times digitally is worth 0.0007 cents.
Yeah, I get that part. All right, so let me ask you a question. If I'm signed to Universal.
Yeah.
I signed a deal with Universal.
Yes.
9 times out of 10, I don't own my masters. They own it because they're putting up the money for me to record all my shit, right?
Well, it depends how you get it, but they can't because they can be like, you might have it done, and they're like, okay, well, shit, we signed you. We're going to get X percent of your publishing, whether it be 10%, 20%, 30%, 40%. And this is where the lawyers come into play because they'll give you, that's why I give them long ass, thick ass, what's it called? Because they, in the wording, because it's wording, you know, the wording can be one half of all of your major whatever, 1% of every 3rd percent. Like the wording of what they say is how they determine, and a contract is non-binding. Mm-hmm. Any contract can be. You just gotta have somebody who can explain or who can write the contract. You know, like for example, I know we talked about it before, but Nelly's contract, he worked it out so that, okay, if I hit this amount of this number of sales, then all my group is guaranteed to have a solo album. And a solo album guarantees X amount of dollars to the artist for a budget.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, like I said, Nelly was like, shit, I did 3-4 platinum. So that means every one of the little chicks, all I had to do was just go to the studio. All I had to do was go to the studio. They were guaranteed a check.
Mm-hmm.
It was on them to go.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So it's the wording of the contract. It's how you negotiate. But all that being said, these niggas ain't gangsters, man. Because they're not the gangsters that they claim to be. They might be gangsters, but they also got enough good sense to go get a lawyer, go get an agent.
I think some people are happy with getting some money in their pocket, though. Because you take a nigga who on Monday had $20 to his name,
mm-hmm.
and if I sign this, I'm going to have $1 million to my name. I'm going to sign it. Because that's $1 million, nigga. I don't know what that means. I don't know that once I sign that, half of it finna go to taxes.
Yeah.
And then when I go diamond,
yeah,
the record label's finna get everything that they spent off the top. You know what I'm saying?
So that's why. That's
everything. Yeah. I'm talking about like video budget, exactly. Recording budget, feature budget, clothing budget. So I'm probably gonna be in the red.
So that's you know, that's on you as the artist, and this is the fucked up part.
But a 21 year old nigga that don't, bro, all I know is the streets, bro, and I know you finna, just $1 million.
How about this? When you
nigga,
was,
I had 30 yesterday.
Watch this. When you was, 16, you was working at Randall's, right?
Right.
The first time you seen Ficka on your check, were you tripping?
Who?
Ficka, the FI.
I didn't even look at that shit.
Oh, Ficka.
I looked at how much was in my pocket.
Yeah, but I'm saying, when I got my first check and looked at it, I was like, man, who the fuck is Ficka, man?
Who the fuck is Ficka and why? Well, let me read. Of course. I was like, I work these hours, why my check minus this?
Exactly.
And my old man told me who Ficka was.
Exactly, right? So it's the same thing. Once I get that first check and I see it, first I got to see it. Mm-hmm. I have to have the wherewithal to, like, I want to see my check. Because some people work jobs for 8-9 years. They know, it's like, I got my money in my bank. I don't care what it say.
Just a lot of niggas don't look at check stubs.
But you have, and it's, you know what I'm saying? But I say, I looked at my check. I'm like, man, what is this? Man, hold up. Man, now. And now you start asking questions. Well, do I have to get that up? Is there a way to get around that? You know what I'm saying? This is the thought process that people who... This is the process that I have. Me, I'm like, well, hold up, man. What's up with this? I'm going to ask questions. Other people be like, eh, well, you know, it ain't that much, so forget it. I ain't tripping.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the attitude I feel like people be have. Like, that's that passive attitude about things that you feel like you can't control. That is how we think about our stuff. We don't be thinking like, man, why? How are they going to tell me what I can do with my money, man? Hold up, now. Nah, I don't want, now. Nah. Like, you have to question authority, or authority will rule you.
Hmm.
You have to question it. You don't have to fight. You don't have to throw a fit, but you at least question it. Question it, like, why is this happening? And when you start, when you get answers, then you can give a good response. But like I said, people be like, oh, man, well, he sold out. I mean, he sold the money, so he got it. Well, nigga, Ralph Lauren ain't sell out. Tommy Hilfiger didn't sell out. You telling me that FUBU came in 3 years and was comparable with these long lasting labels, and I had to sell out? Why would I sell out, man? I've already proved in a short amount of time that I can get the same amount of customers as you. Mm-hmm. So why wouldn't I let this run alongside of you? As Sean John still going? He ain't sold out. Why would he? It don't make sense. That's legacy. That's how you have ownership. So now in 50 years, his son is making money off of Sean John. We as a culture, oh, Sean John, they hire black folks.
When was the last time you bought some Sean John? I can't remember the last time I saw Sean John in the store.
Sean John is in Foley's and JCPenney's.
There ain't no Foley's no more. It's Macy's.
It's in Macy's.
Well, see, I don't be going to Macy's, though.
You know what I'm saying? But it's not. That's what I'm saying.
Well, I'm fashion over Casanova, bro.
Check it out. I've been going to the mall just randomly a lot lately. Randomly, just for like a couple hours, just walk through there and looking at the Fendi and the Gucci and all the high end brands.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized it's not just live, bro. I'm looking at women's and men's. Like, it's not live. It's just expensive.
It's a name.
It's just expensive. That's all. It's expensive, man. Even to Greens Point, going, it's a store in Greens Point that got $500 shoes, man, from Fendi. I'm like, this shit is ugly, man. And I'm telling the chick in there, I'm like, these shoes cost $45. Which one you should think look better? Pointing their mind at her. She's like, well, you know, this is so and so.
It's the name.
It's the name. And, you know, but FUBU is a name. That's what I'm saying. FUBU is a name.
Well, yeah, I do feel like when they sold out, and that's when that FUBU Platinum bullshit came out.
Exactly.
And then that shit like faded away. But it's like it wasn't a regular sauce. Hold on, let's pause. We back.
If you know yeah.
Man, what's your? I know you got one more topic, and then, you know we got to get out of here.
Yeah. Okay, so, you witnessed this. You've been a part of this.
I'm scared.
AAU parents, man.
All the worst.
Are the worst.
Because everybody's kid is a superstar.
Oh my God. Man, look, I just got told by a parent that I cheated their kids into missing some free throws. For all my non-basketball playing listeners, a free throw is when the person is by themselves with nobody playing defense and they have them and the ball and the rim to shoot. Nobody.
It's harder to shoot a free throw than a contested jumper.
But there's nobody. It's not harder.
It's a mental thing. The mental aspect.
Okay, maybe, but I don't think so. I think free throw is literally the easiest shot in basketball because nobody can do anything to you. They can't touch you. They can't scream at you. They can't do nothing to you. All you have to do is throw the ball into the goal. So somehow, I cheated their team by giving. First off, in order to get a free throw, you have to call foul.
Did you call foul?
I called the foul. They got the free throw.
Yeah.
The free throws, not one, not two, but 10, and missed them all. But somehow that was my fault.
The parents said it's your fault.
The parents said I cheated their team, you know, because they go and win contests everywhere else. And let's talk about that. The competition level in these quote unquote, because it's not even AAU, but the competition in the AAU, like, you know your son ain't made his high school team, his middle school team. You know he ain't the best player on his middle school team. He's not getting 30 a game at his middle school. But somehow at AAU, he's getting 30 games. So you telling me that the kids that he plays with at his school, he can't get 30, but he gets he don't even get 30 on the AAU team. But somehow.
I thought AAU was like better than the school team.
How would that be?
Like I saw some video. I'm assuming it was AAU team.
Yeah.
They were watching like Blake Griffin dunk and shit. There's like 10 niggas on this team that's in the NBA right now.
Yeah, I'm saying this.
So I thought the AAU was like.
But AAU, in essence, the AAU team is supposed to be like the ones that you're talking about are the select teams where they go around the country put together the best talent from around the world.
I thought that's all AAU teams were trying to be. I thought AAU.
Yeah, that's what they're trying to be, but it's not what it is, though.
I thought the AAU basketball teams.
Yeah.
Were for basketball what the Little League World Series is.
So, just like the Little League
World Series. I know they go get the little kids from Cuba.
Yeah, they get the best kids, right?
Yeah, and give them green cards and shit.
Yeah, yeah. So
might be wrong about that.
They be 25 years old. They got no facial hair.
Yeah. Nigga from Cuba pitching for the 14-year-olds.
Yeah. So, what I'm saying is.
But he can buy Coronas. Damn, that sounds. I'm toxic.
What I'm saying is, your child has played basketball for an amount of time, and he's not bad. But what I'm saying is, for some reason, every time your child touched the ball, he get fouled.
Mm.
Every time your team has the ball, the other team is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
The other team, every team you play is so incompetent because every time they had a ball, oh, they traveled, they fouled, they did this. But then on your side of the ball, y'all don't foul, y'all don't travel, y'all are perfect, y'all are the best team. But when we isolate these kids one-on-one and see what they've done outside of AAU with a coach who with another coach, they're not getting 30 a game. They're not getting 25 a game. They ain't getting 20 a game. So why is it they believe that when they're in this AAU setting that, oh, yeah, my son is the best and my daughter is the best? Hey, you parents are the worst, bro.
I'm totally done with that club ball situation type shit. You know, my nephews, my brother had a team.
Yeah.
Out there in spring when they were young enough to be on the teams. It was a cool thing my brother was trying to do for the community.
Yeah.
You couldn't pay me to do that shit.
Exactly.
And never in my life had I had to deal with parents like that. And it wasn't even just the parents. It was some of the, I guess you could say, owners of the teams, yeah. bro. Because these niggas act like they really was like Jerry Jones and a McNair.
Exactly.
It was crazy. I had parents threaten to shoot me over losing a little league football game.
And at the end of the day, what they don't understand is that it's about development. Like, and I exactly. keep telling parents, kids, look, until you getting paid for it, all this is practice.
Let me ask you a question.
What's up?
And I'm sure you run across this. Cause you a basketball nigga, I'm a football nigga.
Yeah.
We've both worked in the community.
Very much so.
I'm sure. All right. We've both worked in the community. Yeah. And we've both worked for the organization that we will not name.
Okay. Yeah.
That organization had yeah. youth sports.
Yeah.
And it was that whole, like, everybody gets a trophy type shit.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I feel like there was actually real development in those leagues.
Yes.
Because everybody got a turn. Everyone had a chance. Yeah. We really didn't keep stats.
Yeah.
It was about developing to go to the next level.
Yes.
Now, you've coached and refereed mm-hmm. AAU basketball.
Yes.
I've coached select football club.
Yeah.
Not soccer, but like American yeah, football.
Yeah, American football.
My experience with it is you can't pay me to do it again. I found myself at a church football field.
Yes. Jesus. With the Lord.
With the Lord.
Uh-huh.
Contemplating shooting someone.
Yeah.
Because they wanted to shoot me.
Yeah.
Because their team lost to our team. Our team was like 1-12.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And we, our one.
Yeah.
Was knocking them out of playoff contention.
Oh, okay.
But the crazy part is, We got to check birth certificates and shit before the game.
Yeah.
And I literally have 12-year-olds. These niggas bigger than me.
Yeah.
I'm 6 foot, 260, 270. And I'm like, how old is this nigga again? What good does that do for the development of your teenager when you have a 14-year-old playing down with 12-year-olds?
Well, because.
Explain that to me.
Because. I you know what? Today, this morning. I told a bunch of kids, it's like, look, man, I care about your basketball game more than your mama and more than your daddy. I believe in you more than your mama and your daddy. Mm-hmm. Because your mama and your daddy, they just want to see you win.
Right.
They don't care how you win. They don't care. All they care about most of the time is, oh, my baby won.
But what does that do for the development, though? If I really think my kid has potential to go higher, and I'm gonna say, getting a college scholarship and getting your education paid for is very feasible.
Yeah,
that's very obtainable.
But
the NBA, the NFL, that's a long shot.
That's a long shot. But what I'm saying is, what I care about is, okay, are you able to understand what's going on? Like, your mom's happy if you make 5 shots. I see you making 10 shots. So when you get 5 shots, I'm not happy with that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, no, you made 5 shots, but you should have made 10. I see you making 10. I see you up here. Your parents just want to see you succeed. I want to see you excel and go beyond. I care more about your development than your parents do. All your coaches do. Because they're supposed to.
They should.
Because your coaches see you in a different light
than your parents do.
Some of your parents might have an understanding of how the game goes, and the best parents are the ones who will sit back and let the coach do their job.
I have a full understanding of how football should work.
Yes.
If I had, when my nephews were playing, I let the coaches coach. Mm-hmm. Simply because I feel like they should be in charge of development. Yeah.
Yes.
I have one nephew who called it running back.
Yeah.
I think he's going to the 10th grade.
Yeah.
I can easily say, hey, man, get my nephew to bother to play.
Yeah.
That ain't true development, though.
Don't you hate it when you have a huddle or you have a powwow with your kids and say, we're going to do this. Get on the field, and the parent yells out to their son or daughter to do something that's totally the opposite of what you said, dude?
I hate it. I'm a horrible coach, by the way. Like, I suck at coaching.
Yeah. I don't know if I'm horrible or good, but I know, like, I'm like, hey, like, let's say that y'all run a 4-3.
It's too much.
A 3-4 defense, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the parents, like, blitz him, blitz him, blitz him. Go ahead and blitz him. Like, I literally told the kid to play this zone area. And you yelling the kid to do the opposite of what I said do. So now the kid is conflicted. Who I listen to, my coach, my parents? Because then whatever happens, if it doesn't go perfect, the parent going to say, you're supposed to blitz him. You should have blitzed. You should have blitzed. Well, my job wasn't to blitz right now, mama or daddy. Hold your man. We're not playing the man. I'm playing the zone. Hold number 12. I'm not holding number 12. I'm playing the area. You know, it's the disconnect between the parents, and it always comes down to ego. 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 I want this. I'm going to. That's the, you know.
Coaching is too stressful for me, bro. I don't have the attention span to coach. I be wanting to do some other shit. I'm that supportive parent, uncle that's like, hey, man, yeah, you did a great job. Hey, when this shit over, I'm hungry, bro. We need to go get something to eat or something.
Yeah.
Man, since we didn't travel out here to League City, let's go ahead and hit this outlet up so I can find me some shoes. I don't give a fuck about that winning and losing shit.
Bro, look, I was telling his parents now, like, you think I give a fuck about who, you think I care who wins or lose? You think I'm invested enough to care who, and I don't coach. I haven't coached in like maybe 2 or 3 years. I don't care who wins. I don't care who wins. You know why? Because I care about what happens in the game. I care about how this took place. Were we doing things to improve ourselves? Were we trying to make this better? Were we learning? If you 6'7" and you got 17 layups, everybody's 5'2", I'm not impressed.
I definitely could be a general manager of a sports team, though. I can find talent.
Yeah.
And I can find a coach to coach the talent.
Yeah.
I don't want to coach the talent.
It's hard, man.
I don't want to be. I want to be passionate enough to find a talent, but be able to sit in a luxury box
and just watch it,
drink some yak.
Yeah.
And be like, yeah, I drafted that nigga.
Yeah. Yeah. I can see that, man. Well, you know, 16 shots, man. It was a wonderful podcast today. We ain't have all the sound effects, man. But next week I will be back, man.
Well, hold on. We 2 times a week now, right?
Yeah. So I'm sorry. Yeah. Wednesday, Monday. So Thursday, Wednesday.
So Tuesday and Thursday is when they gonna get it.
Okay, but next show in a couple of days. Wait, we shouldn't say days.
Next show they gonna hear is on Thursday.
Okay. All right. So we'll be shooting again. I mean, we need to go and shoot one, man, and set up a little backdrop so we can have some, you know, some camera view, man. So
I'm
see
working. I'm working on it. All right. Man.
Okay. Because, you know, they be asking the visuals, man, and, you know, they want to see.
I got to get you to do the logo first.
All right. I'm just tonight. I'm dressed tonight, man.
All right.
We out of here, man. Pow, pow. Pow, 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 pow.